You know, a lot of people have their storms through life. Some are big storms, some are small storms. A lot of you know that I'm going through a storm right now, that I have an aneurysm. The night that that doctor came into that room and looked at me, my daughter on one side and Ken on the other, and said, "I've got the MRIs back, you have an aneurysm." Well, it was like, you know. And then she looked at me and she goes, "Do you have any questions?" I couldn't speak. None of us could. She said, "All right, then thank you," and walked out of the room. That was December the 14th. I couldn't get a doctor's appointment. You have to get referral from your primary. You'd go through all of this, as you all know. And so nothing happened until January 12th when I went down to the Baptist Tower and talked to this wonderful, wonderful doctor. To make a long story short, it is a tiny, tiny little blimp. He's not worried about it. He's going to wait until six months from now. And then he will do another MRI. And even if he has to go in, it's right here. It's right here. He can go through the wrist, come back up through the shoulder, and do it right there, just like an aneurysm. So people, when I remember that night, or when everybody left my room, and we had prayed before they did, and then I started praying. And all of a sudden, all of these scriptures that you learned as a child and as you learned as an adult came flooding into me. God is not the author of fear. I will lift up mine eyes to the hills from whence cometh my help. And I got that peace, the peace that passes all understanding. So I can stand here today with a big smile on my face and sing this song. Thank you.
I feel the touch of hands so kind and tender. They're leading me in the path that I must trod.
And here's the big thing.
I have no fear, for Jesus walks beside me. For I'm sheltered in the arms of God. So let the storms rage high, the dark clouds rise, they don't worry me. Safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and naught of earth shall harm me. Shall hear the call from heaven's portals. Come home, my child. It's the last mile you must trod. I'll fall asleep. God's new heaven, sheltered safe within the arms of God. So let the storms rage high. high, the dark clouds rise. They won't worry me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and naught of earth shall harm me. For I'm sheltered in the arms of God. Yes, I'm sheltered in the arms of God.
Thank you, Miss Pam. Welcome everybody to church. Amen. It's good to be in church. And let's get the fire going here to kind of warm things up in here. You know, that's what they call that, a subliminal message, you know. So if you're cold, by the time the announcements are over, you'll be nice and cozy. We welcome you to South Point. Thank you. I got a chance to meet some of our visitors this morning. Thank you guys for coming this morning and worshiping with us here at South Point. We want you to feel welcome. And we're going to sing some more in just a little bit, and I have another special, and we're going to read God's Word together, and we're going to preach God's Word and just have a good time in the Lord today. And we pray that the Holy Spirit will minister to you. Again, if you're visiting with us, we've got some guest cards in the pew rack. Feel free, don't have to, feel free to fill one out and put it in the offering plate. That we've started doing this is at the end of the service, as you exit, you'll have a chance to put something in the offering plate, and those visitors card, guest cards can go in there as well. Don't have a lot of announcements other than next week, which starts next month, this Wednesday night is kind of the official start of our missions month, which is kind of our Super Bowl for South Point, and these are some of the ones that we're having this Wednesday night. Trent Coker from China is going to be with us. Next Sunday morning, we're going to have a combined, all the adult classes are invited in here for a special Sunday school because there's so much information. Brother Ken Fielder, who is a Baptist International Outreach, a Bible translator, just incredible information about the world and the people groups and getting God's Word into the hands of people that do not have God's Word. That's going to be a blessing. Of course, he'll be preaching for us. The Mission Director for Vision Baptist Missions is going to be with us. Our own Wayne Brown, we're going to have a little interview format with him on the 13th because we're desiring to partner with him with a number of community impact ministries, and which is the name of his organization. Patrick Henry, not the Patriot, but I'm sure this one is a Patriot, missionary to Argentina. Matt Parrott, who we met when we had our tri-state missionary to Bolivia. Then we've also got coming up Benjamin Broyles, a veteran missionary to Albania. Excuse me, I almost said that the wrong way. Albania. Of course, Faith Promise Sunday on the 27th. That's the chance when we turn in our Faith Promise commitments for 2022. Also going to have just various video shout outs from our missionaries as well. Along with what I just said about Wayne Brown, go to this next one. One of the things we're wanting to do, and we always do kind of a little project each year, and this is kind of the one that we want to do. And Brother Wayne, we've already partnered with him some stuff, and Brother Wayne is just a proactive thinker and stuff. He's wanting to get some updated equipment that he can use on the field. He's going into disaster relief. Of course, he does a lot of cooking for first responders and for the homeless. He partners with other churches and other ministries. We're going to talk about that on the 13th, but we'd like to give a designated offering. If you would like to help with that, you can designate on your offering envelope to go to Wayne Brown or Impact Ministries. That will be a real blessing. And more about that later. And then also, you don't have time to read all this, but we're not going to do a Food from Around the World Sunday night like we often do. Just with the COVID thing, we're almost at that point where we'll be able to do those things. But instead, we're going to kind of do a fun thing, and this is Sweets from Around the World. Now I got your attention. And we're going to, our Sunday school classes are going to make cookies individually wrapped, carefully monitored and stuff, that we're going to have on the last Sunday, our Faith Promise Sunday, kind of be a celebratory thing. And you'll have cookies from Denmark and Sweden and, you know, cookies. You can't go wrong with cookies and sweets like that. So anyway, Miss Cheryl's going to give you a little more detail as we go down the road on that. Just kind of a fun thing, kind of a touch point for us as we think about missions, okay? All right, so good to see all you guys. I'm going to preach the devil out of you in a few minutes, so just kind of buckle up, all right?
Brother Lynn? Let's get ready in the presence of Jehovah. Let's stand together. Sing with me.
In the
Please open your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 1. We'll be reading together verse 3 through verse 7. We'll be reading out of the King James Version for continuity. So if you have another translation that you brought with you, you can find a Bible in the pew, or you can read from the screen as we begin. Let's go ahead and begin. I thank God, whom I serve from my forefathers, with pure conscience, that without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, I am persuaded that in thee also. Wherefore, I put thee in remembrance, that thou stir up the gift of God that is in thee by the putting on of my hands. For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come together today seeking to hear your voice in our life. Help us, Lord, as we hear the word today, to say, Lord, speak to me new and fresh. Guide me and lead me. and to thy truth by your Holy Spirit. Soften my heart. Give me a willingness to serve. Lord, help me in the areas that I need help. Strengthen me for the week ahead. And Lord, in all things, may I glorify you in all that I say or do. Anoint our pastor as he brings the bread of life today. It may not fall upon deaf ears, but may it accomplish all that you send it to do in each of our lives. And we thank you and we praise you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good singing, wasn't it? Miss Pam, good job. What a classic song, too, that. And our choir, as always, great, great job. Is it me, or have I noticed our choir has grown in number over the last few weeks? That is a good, good thing. Thank you, Brother Lynn, for your good work there. We are in 2 Timothy chapter 1, the first 7 verses. As you know, we have been preaching about faith and faithfulness the last 3 Sundays. On January the 9th, the initial message was, I have kept the faith, which was Paul's declaration to Timothy as he penned some of his last recorded words of how he had been faithful to the end if in fact it was going to be then for him, and it was. And he taught us how to live today in light of tomorrow and eternity. That's why we keep the faith. In that passage, we talked about a faith that fights, a faith that finishes, a faith that keeps, and a faith that will eventually one day crown us. January 16th, we preached from James 4:17. I love this title called Omission Control, where we spoke of the good that we know that we should faithfully do, and when we don't do it, it is a specific sin laid to our charge. That good which God speaks to us specifically about doing, we talked about that. The lesson is that God speaks to us specifically about our life and gives us strength not to do bad, but opportunity to faithfully do good. And one point in that passage, here is the outline, informed enlightenment. Yeah, go back to that one, Josh. Informed enlightenment. We read from God's word what he says that we should do, and then the Spirit of God speaks to our heart, therefore to him that knoweth do good. But then sometimes we practice intentional avoidance. There's one thing about it, when we sin in ignorance, but there's another time when we sin with our eyes wide open. I call it intentional avoidance. Him knoweth do good and doeth it not. Intentional avoidance. We know. And one point that we made is that often when we don't do the good that we know we should do, sometimes it's a precursor and it sets us up to do the bad that we know that we shouldn't do. David, when kings go out to war, he decided not to. And what happened? He got involved with Bathsheba. And then that produces an individual indebtedness. To him, it is sin. Me and you may be standing next to each other, and God, the Holy Spirit, speaks to my heart about speaking to an individual, because the Holy Spirit knows how what I say may have an influence in this situation, that person, and I choose not to do it. That individual indebtedness is to me. We move on, the next one, and that is, we talked about last week in the Old Testament, we talked about David, a little known story called Stayed by the Stuff, in which 400 warriors went to war with him, 200 he kept behind. They were exhausted from previous battles and a three-day journey, and David commissioned them to stay with all the equipment and stuff while they went and fought the Amalekites. They went and fought them. They came back at kind, and they got all their goods back, and the spoil of the Amalekites. Came time to divvy it up, and the 400 warriors did not want to share with the 200. And David stepped in and said, no, those that have been faithful to do what I asked them to do, they share equally alike. And I gave you four things here. That wasn't the total message, but there were three other major points. We should be faithful in the intense stuff. When it's a fight, when it's a spiritual firefight and it is all hands on deck, those 400 warriors, they were in the battle and they fought that. We should be faithful in those. We should also be faithful through the incendiary stuff. That was two situations David, between his own people, had to negotiate and calm down. When they were mad about the 200 getting the stuff, and they were also mad about the Amalekites taking their wives and children and livestock, and David had to negotiate that. How we should be faithful when things aren't hunky-dory and tensions are high. And then faithful in inconsequential stuff, that which may not be on the front lines, but it is just as vital, because that is exactly what God called you to do. Somebody, whoever's keeping the nursery right now, they're faithful in what we would term inconsequential stuff. It's not inconsequential to this pastor or those that are involved in security or whatever. We're to be faithful in everything, because there's no generals in God's army per se. We are all warriors in the battle for Jesus Christ. And then faithful in the intentional stuff. The intentional stuff was the fact that David, after that incident, made it a precept, made it a law, if you will, that everybody that is part of a team they participate in, they are rewarded equally. And in other words, there are things that we set in motion in our Christian life that are intentional that will help us when these other three things come in our life. So even Wednesday night, we looked at the verse, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2, in stewards, it is required that a man be found faithful. And that is our theme, be found faithful. And the title of the message then was another word about faithfulness to the faithful. So on the first message this year, we started at the end of 2 Timothy, where Paul said, I have fought a good fight, I've finished my course, I've kept the faith. To end this series, I want to start at the beginning of that book, chapter 1, verses 1 through 7, where we will look at one of the things that keep us from exercising our faith and our faithfulness, and that is the thing of fear. Today's message is called The Fierce Foe of Faithfulness. Now, if you examine these, and we read them a minute ago, if you were to examine these seemingly innocuous introduction to the book of 2 Timothy, you might miss what Paul is trying to do as he writes to his young protege in the faith, Timothy. But by the time we get to verse 7, you begin to see that the words to this young man was Holy Spirit inspired, as all of God's word is, and preserved to help Timothy and all who have their walk in their faith, that a spirit of fear overcomes them. Verse 7, by the time we get there, it is one you probably know the most in that first chapter. For God has not given us a spirit of fear. Now, I'm a big thing on examining these seemingly mundane verses, and none of God's word is mundane. Again, it's how we sometimes view them. And we apply it to our lives. Here with Timothy, somebody who had been faithful, was being faithful in the work he was doing, but yet there seemed to be some real fear in his life despite that. And Paul, even in his introduction to this book, which was just as important as the benediction to this book, he would write some things that, if we examine them closely, I think as the reader, Timothy, and now us, we would understand where Paul was going. In 2 Timothy, there's no less than 25 challenges that Paul gives to Timothy, to us, and to the church about our life. Now, his name was Timothy. We know that name. It's a common name today. It's not like Mephibosheth or, you know, Jeroboam. You know, Timothy is a modern name. He was the young protege of Paul, who was probably converted during Paul's first missionary evangelistic campaigns in the area of Lystra, where Paul was conducting campaigns. He was probably a teenager when he, a young man when he was converted. Paul would later call him his son in the faith. By the time Paul came around the second time, Timothy had built as a youngster a good reputation of faithfulness and service to the Lord. Paul would make him part of his mission team, and you would see him in many of the books of the Bible. If you did a little concordance of the time Timothy is mentioned in Scripture, you'll see a lot. He often served as an emissary to other churches like Philippi, and so he stayed very busy in the work of the Lord. He would play a major role in that hotbed of evangelism in the area of Ephesus, and would serve there. In 1 Timothy, Paul would write him and give instructions for the order of the church, you know, things like deacons and church order, the workings of the body of Christ. And I personally believe there were two imprisonments of Paul, that he was in prison from Rome, he was out for a short time, then he was put back in prison when Nero started heating things up after the Roman fire, and he wanted to tag Christians as the culprits of why that happened, when many historians believe Nero is the one that set his own town on fire. Paul is now in 2 Timothy, he's incarcerated in the Mamertine prison, and Paul is a realist. He understands that this could be it, though he planned for the future, as we shared. and he shares those words about keeping the faith. He knew that any moment Nero could just on a whim decide to execute him. He's giving final, instructive, encouraging words, knowing that Timothy would continue his ministry without his spiritual, pastoral, human blanket, if you will, with Paul going into eternity. By this writing, Timothy is still young. He's probably around the age of Brother Jake and ministering to a lot of elders. And so there was trepidation and fear. And it kind of sifts through as you study about Timothy and you read Scripture. And here are several things. Number one, he was young. We get a hint of Paul's challenge in 1 Timothy 4:12 when he said, "Let no man despise thy youth, but be an example." You know, you can be very young in the faith, very young in years, and you can inspire a lot of people. I'm inspired by a lot of our young people in our church. Their faith, their zeal, their fervor, their willingness to serve. Secondly, he was following in the footsteps, and let's just be honest, the great militant missionary, the Apostle Paul, who no doubt was a giant of a man, though he called himself the chief of sinners. Third, Timothy was having to lead people much older than him. That was a big deal back then. It was a big deal in Jewish circles. It certainly became a big deal in the early Christian church. And he probably got some undeserved slams at him and simply just says, "Oh, you're just too young to understand that." Fourth, he had to deal with slick-talking, highly influential false teachers who could easily sway the majority to their side with their wrong doctrine and wrong living, but yet they could talk out of both sides of their mouth. So these are things that Timothy was up against, and as faithful as he was, there was a certain amount of fear in his heart, just like in our Christian life, just like things that we fear every day as we serve Christ and want to stand for Him. The opposition of unbelievers, the opposition in our own family, the feeling that we don't deserve to be able to do this, we're not worthy, and all of those things. And the devil takes that on you, on your heart and your mind and your being, and he attempts to paralyze you with the great paralyzer, which is fear. I am afraid. You know, I said Wednesday night, there's two extremes sometimes in our lack of faithfulness. Number one, and they're on opposite spectrums. Number one is apathy. You know, I don't care. Okay, yeah, I know I'm supposed to get the gospel out. I know I'm supposed to be active in service. And I'll give all kinds of excuses, but the core of it, the heart of it is, you know, I don't care enough to do it. Now, nobody will ever tell you that, but their life speaks that. Then the other extreme is fear. There is a part of me I want to. I know I need to. I should. But it scares me. It scares me to get out of my comfort zone. I believe Timothy went through a lot like that. So in these first seven verses, I want to give you four things that Paul weaved in here in his letter to help Timothy. And there they are. He gave reassurances that fight fear. The reassurances, which we need. He mentioned some remembrances, not just in this section, but before and after. But remembrances that fight fear. And then rekindlings, verse 6 specifically, that fight fear. And then relyings. In other words, what we can rely on in our Christian life to fight fear. So let's begin the first one, verses 1 through 4. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, according to the promise of life, which is in Christ Jesus. Definitive statement there. To Timothy, my own, my dearly beloved son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I want to give you six reassurances. The first one is this, just subtly wedged in here, and it says in the second verse, to Timothy, my dearly beloved son. And that first reassurance is his kinship. Kinship. Paul wasn't related by blood to Timothy, but by the blood of Christ as he was related to Timothy. But because of Timothy's second birth, and he and Paul were related. Timothy was no doubt saved as Paul traveled the area Timothy was from, Lystra. Lystra, by the way, is the town in which Paul was stoned and left for dead. Many scholars believe he actually died, and his vision in, I think, 2 Corinthians chapter 12 was where he said, "I was taken up to the third heaven." So Timothy would have been in that community that saw the miracle that happened with Paul. But Paul considered his relationship to Timothy because of the gospel like he was his son in the faith. He calls him that in 1 Timothy. "I am reassured to know that in this spiritual firefight we are engaged in that can sometimes bring fear to the forefront of our mind, it is reassuring to know that I'm not in this thing alone. I am with brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ." We have a band of brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. By the way, that introduction that says grace, mercy, and peace, that was really only applied to the pastoral epistles. The general church introduction would be grace and peace to the churches, the 12 churches scattered across. Like in the book of James and different ones. But when he wrote to Timothy and he wrote to Titus, he said, "Grace, mercy, and peace." Now, that doesn't pass my looking. Why? Because often Christian leaders, pastors, associates, those that are leading in ministry, we need mercy. Why do we need mercy? Because we make a lot of mistakes. We are frail. We rely on the same grace that you rely on, and we need the same grace. And our mistakes sometimes are bigger, and they affect more people sometimes, not always. And so what do we need? We need mercy. That's a side note, no extra cost for that. The second reassurance is gratitude. He begins by saying, "I thank God, whom I serve from my forefathers." Anytime Paul would mention some of his brothers and sisters in Christ, he would say, "I thank God for you." Gratitude. Gratitude. Often as Paul would begin to pray, God would recall to his mind all the men and women whom he served with and would express in his letters a thankfulness for them. When you hear from a fellow Christian leader who says he or she is thankful for you, you have a Christian friend says, "You know, I'm so thankful you're in my life." What does that do to you? That brings great reassurance in your faith. It can only help us in our walk. So here's my point. Verbalize your gratitude in prayer and in print and for that person, because you never know who you might be helping. If you're dealing with some trepidation in your Christian walk, one of the first things the devil does to instill fear in you is to make you think you aren't as loved and appreciated by others like you are. And that is a key quiver in his arrows. Paul was thankful for them. Number three, another reassurance, intercession. He said, "I am praying for you. I am praying for you. That without ceasing I have remembrance of thee in my prayers night and day." The same verse that he thanked God for Timothy, he said that he regularly interceded to God on behalf of Timothy. Not only did he thank God for Timothy and felt a kinship, but he continued that in prayer. Intercession would be like this: "Lord, I know Timothy is young, but help him to realize he has all the tools needed to lead your people." You know, which Brother Bill, you're back there, right, Brother Bill? Just made me think when I was preparing this. We have not. Our last 2 years, we had an official Saturday day of prayer in which you could come and at your leisure on a Saturday morning from like 9 to 1, and come and pray for 15 minutes with a prayer list. And those last 2 years that we've done that, God has blessed our church in unbelievable ways. And your sorry pastor has not scheduled that yet. Before this week is out, we're going to schedule another Saturday. Brother Bill, help me remember. The fourth reassurance is fellowship. I desire to spend time with you. Greatly, verse 4, greatly desiring to see thee. Greatly desiring to see thee. Fellowship with fellow believers is a fear reliever. It is a calmer. It is where you feel a kinship with fellowship. The ministry of fellowship is a powerful ministry. Whether it's in church, Sunday school, Wednesday night, small groups, Bible study, or social endeavors with others, they're vital and used in the right way to bolster our faith and knowing that, you know, I got other fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. Fellowship and kinship go hand in hand. And then there's empathy. He says, being mindful of thy tears. Mindful. Now, Paul may have recounted the last time he and Timothy parted, whenever that was, the tears that were shed, maybe Acts 20 at Ephesus. Maybe he was recounting a letter from Timothy to Paul in which he might say, Paul, this situation here in Ephesus has just brought me to tears. I don't know what it is. But there was empathy. There was sympathy. Someone says, empathy is your pain in my heart. And so he had empathy and sympathy for them. Quite possibly Timothy's tears came from him knowing that he was in prison and that he may never see the Apostle Paul again, which would, again, foster sometimes fear as he thought about that. You can be a soothing salve of sympathy that sometimes other people need. Paul understood that. Number 6, blessing. He talks about in verse number 4, as we read this passage, it says, greatly desiring to see thee, being mindful of thy tears, that I may be filled with joy. Basically, what he was saying is, Timothy, to be able to see you again or to even remember and think about you, it blesses me when I think about you and I think about what you have done for me. The reassurance that brings blessing. I think Timothy was one of Paul's closest friends. What helps in the Christian life is a kinship of family, a thankfulness for each other, a sense of interceding one for another, an eagerness to spend time with each other, an understanding of our problems, and the knowledge that we bring each other joy by our presence. Amen? Those are reassurances. But then there's remembrances. There's remembrances all through that. Let me zero in on a couple of things. Verse 5, look. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and in thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. A tool of identification that Paul did was by invoking a remembrance. First of all, he talks about the unfeigned faith or a genuine faith that Timothy had. Timothy's faith was genuine. The Greek word for unfeigned is the word from which we get hypocrisy or hypocritical. Except unfeigned means unhypocritical faith. When I call to remembrance the unhypocritical faith that you have, when we fear, if we do not have a genuine faith, it cannot get us to the finish line. It just can't. If we don't have the resource and energy and synergy of why we serve, and that is a genuine faith in Jesus Christ, it's just not going to make it. But Timothy had a genuine, and he reminded him of your unfeigned faith. Sometimes the only thing that gets you through is knowing that I am a child of the living God, and He lives within me. Amen? And to see a genuine faith demonstrated helps us to stay strong in the midst of our own battles. Faith lived out truly in the real world does so much for our walk in faith and our casting away fear in our heart. When we fear, we must remember. And then the second thing here, a godly family. Genuine faith, but a godly family. He brings up two near and dear people to Timothy, his mother and his grandmother. And he recounts that that genuine faith emanated from the faith of your mother and your grandmother. Now, Timothy was the son of a Greek man who was probably a Roman citizen, and his mother was Jewish. So there was unbalance there from the get-go, and we don't know much about, we don't know anything about Timothy's father, but we do know much about the faith, and it was important for a Jewish mother to raise their child the right way. And no doubt Timothy had been taught scriptures, the Old Testament scriptures, which set the precedent for the day when the evangelistic team would come in. And because he knew from scriptures, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. And so they had mastered Timothy's schooling with the teaching of the Old Testament scriptures. And so when the vine was ripe for picking, when the gospel was given, Timothy and his family trusted Christ as their Savior. Now, I wanted to use an illustration. I'm going to use a living illustration for this. Brother Jake, I want you to come to the pulpit. I asked Brother Jake, tell me in your life, who were the ones that you saw that were faithful, that made a difference in your Christian life? Go.
Pastor asked me to share just briefly about that very thing. And I started thinking about the importance of faithfulness and it being demonstrated in our lives and how it shapes young people. I thought about my dad. The Bible tells us that Paul, he wrote to the Corinthians and he told them, follow me as I follow Christ, or imitate me as I imitate Christ. And there are a lot of people in my life as a young person that helped shape me. But when I think of somebody that had the most influence over me, I certainly think of my dad. I thought about how it came to be, and the reality is there are a lot of people I could share about, but he didn't just go to church. He didn't just go to church. He brought church home.
Amen.
And he lived out his faith very boldly for all of us to see. I don't remember a weekend when I wouldn't come into the den, walk in and see my dad sitting in his recliner reading his Bible. Or if he wasn't sitting there reading his Bible, I would see that his Bible was out and he had been reading his Bible. I remember going on car rides with him and listening. He'd be listening to some preaching, or he would share his favorite preacher with me, or he'd play some gospel music. He would tell me about his devotions. He would just talk to me about it. If something broke down at our house, we had a big property and a well and all that stuff. And if the pump went down, or if the lawnmower broke, or if the car RV caught on fire one time, all that stuff. If that happened, one of the first things he would do would be bring me over. I'm talking, I was a young kid. He'd bring me over to it and he'd say, Jake, this is what just happened. And before we start working on it, we're going to pray about it. And he'd pray and then he'd start working. But he did that for me to see, and he was always very intentional about that. He took me with him to hospital visits. He took me with him to Gideon events, to the rescue mission. And I didn't know what was happening at the time, but my life was being shaped by the faithfulness of somebody else. I was seeing that faithfulness played out. He was faithful in the good and the bad. He was faithful when things were difficult. He had battles with cancer. He had a broken back, death of loved ones, sickness. Career mm-hmm. setbacks and disappointments. We went through church splits, and he had some wild kids. Not me, but he had other wild kids.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. He was not immune to the difficulties of life, but he was also never seemed to be thrown off by them. He was faithful. His faithfulness inspired others. And, you know, when I think about the testimony of many of our family members, he didn't come from a home of Christians. Matter of fact, I think in his side of the family, he was probably the first one to become a Christian. And so he began to live that out. Mom said that after Dad got saved, he was just a different person. She said that Russ was so different that I realized there was something wrong with me. He was so different, I realized there was something wrong with me. She said, I went and I rededicated my life to the Lord because I wanted to grow spiritually. I wanted to be like that. I wanted to grow with him, and I sure didn't want him to outgrow me. And I think of his kids. His kids have all trusted in the Lord, remained faithful in the ministry to this day. One by one, he's watched his grandchildren come to know the Lord.
Amen.
His parents both eventually trusted in the Lord before they passed. And it's not all to brag on just one man. I don't want to stand up here and brag on my dad, but I want you to see the impact mm-hmm. that your faithfulness can have on your family and on those around you. And I also offer you a warning, because what I've seen in working with teenagers is that a lack of faithfulness can have just as much of an impact.
Yes, yes.
They see it. And so the question is, what example will you set for others to imitate? And will you allow your life to be the visible demonstration of faithfulness that others need.
Amen. It's powerful, comes from real people making an impact. The third thing, and we must move quickly, verse 6, wherefore I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. Now, we think about rekindling. Of course, it's a remembrance here, but I want to focus on that you stir up the gift of God, which is a rekindling. Timothy, you're gifted. God has gifted you with unique talent and gifts to use for his honor and glory. And so Paul right then was restoking that fire. Thou stir up the gift of God. When Jeremiah got very, very depressed from the persecution that was going on, he wrote in chapter 20, verse 9, but his word, and he had just talked about, I'd just like to get away from it all. But then he said, but his word was in mine heart as a burning fire shut up in my bones, and I was weary with forbearing, and I could not stay. 2 Peter 3:1 says, this second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you in both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance. A remembrance and a rekindling of that. Now, often rekindlings take place when there is real apathy or there's lack of service, where we're not doing what we know we're supposed to do, but apathy creeps in and basically says without saying, I don't really care. Fear says, I'm afraid to do the work. Apathy says, I don't care about the work. Fear says, I'm afraid to do the work, or I'm afraid in the work. Paul says, stir up that gift of God that you had when you were ordained. Paul reminds him of the time he was ordained to this work and why he was ordained to this work. Do you know how you can get right with God as a believer who's kind of lost his way? You do it by starting back where you left off and just beginning right there, because you already know to do that. Today we call it getting back on the horse or getting back on the bicycle and start pedaling. You know how to pedal. The only thing left to do is simply getting back on it and pedaling. Now, what are the gift or gifts that God has given you? What are you passionate about? What can you do well, or you think that you can do well? So here's my question. Are you using that? If you're gifted in this area, are you using it for the Lord's work? Are you using it at His church, whether it's your mind, your body, your emotions, your giftedness? What are you passionate about? And if not, when are you going to start using it? That gift for Jesus Christ. Stir up the gift of God in you. This is not original with me, but a stirring up requires us to do these four things. Be strong in our walk. Be spiritual in our worship. Be studious in the Word. Be steady in the work. For in other words, we can say, look, I'm going to get up and I'm going to start serving the Lord. And I'm going to come strong to the hoop with that. When you come to church, you say, you know what, I'm going to center everything out. When I'm in here in corporate worship, I am going to focus on the words of the song and what they mean. I'm going to listen to God's word. I'm not just going to recite it like a mime. I'm going, I'm going to listen to it. And then when the pastor preaches, I'm going to soak that in like a sponge. And maybe I've heard this verse or this message before, a portion of that, but there's a nugget. There's something there that can hit me right in the heart. Be studious in the Word. Just read, reread. Say, you know, I've caught myself doing this. I've caught myself reading. I go, you know what? My mind was drifting when I was reading that. I'm starting over again. I'm going to read the whole thing. I almost use it as punishing on myself, but as a challenge to myself, focus on the Word. And then be steady. Don't be here, then to here, then here, then here. If anything, our Christian life, our lows should be higher than the lows of days gone by, and where it's more like this. You're going to have good days. You're going to have bad days. But they don't need to be like here and then here. Be steady in your work. And then number four, reliance that fight fear. This could be a whole message. It's not going to be. Verse 7, we know this verse. For God has not given us the spirit of fear. We know what that is. Paralyzing. Stops us in our tracks. Says, I've got to quit fearing before I can do the next thing in the Lord's work. So we just put our Christian walk on hold. God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. What are the things we can rely on beside a spirit of fear? We can rely on the love of our Savior for us, our love to Him, and we can utilize it. These three things, they speak to our spiritual, our emotional, and our mental person. God ministers to the whole of our body through Jesus Christ, that spirit of love. There is no fear in love, 1 John 4:18 says, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear has torment. He that fears is not made perfect or mature in love. God's love for us, our love for Him, others' love for us, and our love for them are strong emotional, spiritual bonds that help drive out fear and anxiety. Listen, if I know you love me, that will help me like you just don't know. A spirit of power. Jesus came and said unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore. Make no doubt about it. Satan is powerful. Your flesh is powerful. The world is powerful to speak untruth into your life and to etch away at your Christian life. It is powerful. Make no doubt about it. Amen. But greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. And the power of Almighty God, utilized by faith and trusting Him, not in our own devices, which we can live a life with our own devices, but it is not going to be the life that is going to be pleasing to God and to ourselves in the end. A spirit of power that God gives us, and that is from the blessed Holy Spirit of God. And then a sound mind. There's no mistake that word is used in our English Bible. Timothy, God can get your mental state right so you're not constantly thinking about what you're afraid of. God can balance your mind and keep your thinking from going too crazy. God's power produces, we're almost done, a saneness, a calm demeanor of stability in the midst of chaos. It is like the soldier in the midst of a firefight, which there is a lot to be afraid about. People, fellow soldiers, are afraid. But that soldier, he stands firm. He holds his weapon at post, and he does his job. And you get a sense by looking at him. Not only is he looks calm on the outside, there's something in there going on in his heart and in his mind that keeps that saneness in the midst of confusion and chaos. God can deliver that to us. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Philippians 2:5. Romans 12:2. Do not be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. In 1 Corinthians 2:16 it says, but we have the mind of Christ. that covers that. Faithfulness. We got a lot of work to do, but we can do it just by trusting in our Commander-in-Chief, Jesus Christ, and just being faithful with following Him. I want to show you this little clip. The video image is kind of dark. It is the closing of Paul's admonition to Timothy. It's about 2 minutes, and then we're going to go into time of invitation. And it is as this movie, Paul, the Apostle of Christ, depicts Paul getting ready to go. And the myriad of followers, including Luke, the apostle, he said, only Luke is with me there. And the Christians there in Rome following Paul to his place of execution. And you hear these words that Paul writes to Timothy as he takes his last steps of the way. Go ahead.
To Timothy, my dear son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. Do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, or of me, his prisoner. Rather, join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This is my gospel, for which I am suffering even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But God's word is not chained. For I am already being poured out like a drink offering. The time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race.
Father, thank you for time in your word. Thank you for the testimony about faithfulness. Speak to our hearts. May we take that step of faithfulness by taking that step of faith. For someone here that doesn't know you as Savior, my greatest prayer today is for them. As other believers are praying for those that know not the Savior, that might be in this building right now, we pray for their soul. We pray you'll save them. We pray they'll take a step of faith and tell somebody, coming down this aisle, telling somebody they're with, that they know is a believer, that we can take God's word and show them how to be saved. For those that have made a decision, they're sitting on a decision, and they need to make it public, Father. There's power in that, Father. help them take that next step of faith and letting the church know, this is what I want to do for Jesus Christ. Father, help us, be with us as we sing. May we pray. May we sing as we pray. May we pray as we sing. And may we make decisions for you, whatever it may be. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Brother Lynn.
'Tis so sweet to trust Him.